John Hanning speaking. That is what is recorded in the history. The whole year the Kawaka just met one bearded, smelly white man. Was that he met this one lonely, lost white man. How is that possible? How is it possible? Then they teach us in primary school. Stanley passed Karagwe. He met Manuka. He went to Mbarara. He's a slave. He was having a big tea.
A child is dying of malaria in Africa. Now, to get the dose of life-saving anti-malaria is about $5. But there is no government to give anti-malaria. When somebody gets malaria, if they have no money, they get ill and die. So, the question that I was asking and many people were asking was, if you really want to help children, why begin with a disease that they don't have? Why not go home? Why not look for something that is killing them?
This is Oxford, Cambridge, where you go to get this degree, where you get the first degree, which is a BA, bachelor's degree. You know, they don't believe in marriage. So they don't, you know, the only thing they can give you is a bachelor's degree, you know? So, because you can stumble on a conference like this and get shocked when a few ideas are thrown in your head. I don't believe what Nana Sekhmet said. I don't believe that kind of stuff. It's okay. You know, they teach you how to critique, not to believe anything. You know, when they say, what do you think about black people building their own institutions? You say, well, it has its own advantages and disadvantages. Only.
The high culture of Egyptian civilization that starts around the Nile Valley eventually ends up here. In the Giza Plateau, in the pyramids of Giza, one of the highest high technical civilizations that African people put together. Starting all the way from Uganda, covering present-day Sudan, and going up here in Egypt.
has established that more than 7 million years ago, a black woman stretched forth her hands under God and gave us the first human being. In the beginning was a black woman. This black woman lived at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. This black woman lived in the Idrakrustin region, known in ancient time as the land of the gods. This black woman lived at the source of the Nile. This black woman lived between the two domes of the Great Rift Valley. This black woman's genes run through the genes of every human being. This black woman's DNA is the string that connects every person that walks on earth. That is why we say that let him that is worthy be worthy still, and let him that is righteous be righteous still. So behold, I come quickly. My reward is with me to give unto every man and woman for and according to his reward should be. For in the beginning was a black woman. This woman gave rise to a human. Never was a time when a black woman was not. Never will be time when black people will cease to be. Because we are eternal, my brothers and sisters.
So in the name of the Creator revealed to all unknown by many names, in the name of our ancestors whose legacy we must all bear, I bear witness today that regardless to land, label, or language, there is but a Creator. In one part of the world, this Creator is known as Luhanga. In another part of the world, the Creator is known as Edeka. He is known as Jok among the Deng or the people of Sudan. He is known as Olatangana among the Nyamwezi. The Giriama call him Wele. The Shona call him Mwali. So when they greet, they say Tenda Mwali. Among the Zulu, they call him Nkuru Nkulu. In Nigeria, he's called Alealum, Elegba, Bablawaye. The Creator is called Obatula, and Obatula is the wife of the man god Oludumale. Because in Africa, you can't have a god without a goddess. In ancient Egypt, he was called Atum, Amen, Amen-Ra. In ancient Egypt, he was called Aton. In ancient Egypt, he was called Jehuti. He was called Sekhmet. In ancient Greece, God was called Apollo, which means black one. Athena, which means black one. Artemis, which means black one. Zeus, who was the father of the plethora of gods, who came from Africa. Because almost all the Greek gods came from Africa. In ancient China, the god was called, God was called Confucius. The Japanese call him Shinto. All these were different images of God. I bear witness as an African man, and we bear witness as African people that our beginning was great and good, so shall our development to eternity be. So if you dare, you speak truth, you do justice, and you walk in the ways of righteousness. So we go immediately into the question of what happened at the beginning and who were there at the beginning of creation. Was it the melanated African people that populate the area of the Great Lakes? Was it the Cro-Magnon that came from Baka, Lake Baka, and part of Russia, and parts of France, and parts of Spain, about 20,000 years ago, or the ancestor of the European? Was it the Shandalade man with the oldest fossil in China, represented by the Peking scar? Was it the Java man? Was it the Mongoloid? Was it the Shandalade, you know, are the Chinese? Was it the Cro-Magnon, are the white people? Was it the red people that populate India? Who are the people that were there at the beginning of humanity? Who are there at the beginning of the creation? When Earth began to sustain life and to sustain us as a people, who were the people that populated the world at the time? So, I will not devolve into how Earth was created. So I'm not going to take you into the different strands and different arguments associated with the creation of the earth, other than to say that the earth, which used to be a gaseous matter that circulated around the sun, and with the movement of planets, of the interstellar planets, that this earth begins to cool and form the solid, and all the time, you know, this solid would crumble on itself, and water would collect, you know, would collect in some of the craters, and after thousands or eons of years, earth is ready to sustain life. Earth begins about 3.4 billion years. 3.4 billion years, our earth is in its infancy, and by 500 million years, by that we've gone through the age of metazoa and protozoa, and 400 million years you get the age of anemones and the jellyfish. In fact, 400 million years has been known as the age of fish. So from the age of fish, we will fast forward up to about 80 million years when you get the age of what they call the prosimian. Why do they call it the prosimian? Pro means before, and simian means monkey. Because the age of monkey doesn't come into play until about 40 million or 45 million years. So the prosimian, the simian is of course means monkey. So when you hear simian virus, it means a monkey virus. So prosimian starts from 80 million years up to about 40 to 45 million years. So about 50 million years, there is the tectonic movement. This tectonic movement separates the earth. Before that, the earth was all one landmass, and this landmass was surrounded by water. So the tectonic movement, the movements of the plates underneath the earth begin to move. And as they move, what do we see? We see North and South America together on one side. They are still together. North and South America did not separate when the rest of the world separated about 50 million years ago. No. Then we see Africa separating from Europe. Europe at the time, of course, didn't exist, but Europe is also not a continent because a continent is massive landmass surrounded by water. So we'll call it Western Asia or Eurasia. So Western Asia separates from Africa, although parts of present-day Spain around Gibraltar is still close to Africa, almost walking distance. You could jump from Africa into Spain. And parts of Italy are also still close to Africa. And there's, of course, the Erasmus of Suez, which is a very big, massive corridor, which was severed from Africa in 1856 by a Frenchman named Gillespie. So Australia also goes its own way. So the continental drift, the tectonic movements that produce the drifting of the continent, when you hear genetic drift, it means the drifting of the genes, genes moving away from the mother gene. So the continental drift is the continents moving away from the mother continent, or from the center of the earth, which at that time, of course, we would prefer to call Africa. Now, about 40 million years, the 40 million years is known as the age of monkeys. So at that time, the whole world is, of course, covered by a forest. And this forest spreads almost from what is present-day Pacific, you know, to the Atlantic. From the North Pole to the South Pole is covered in forest. The world is all cold, is very cold and very wet. Now, about in all these forests, you have different, you know, forms of monkeys that populate the earth. So what these monkeys have long prehensile tails. They have got fur covering their body. They have got straight movement or forward ambulation. They've got a small cranium, so they have got definitely a smaller brain. And they have no culture. They can't make tools. They have no articulated language. But the monkeys blanket almost all continents, North America, Americas, which was still North and South together, and Europe and Africa and the rest of Asia. Now, this would go on until about 25 million years. 25 million years, a new primate appears on the scene in the form of a chimpanzee or the great chimpanzee. Now, this great chimpanzee comes about 25 million years. How does this come about? How does the chimpanzee separate itself from the monkeys? Of course, the chimpanzee is very close to them. It comes out of the monkeys because the monkeys, you know, were the first mammalian to inhabit the earth at the time. But the chimpanzee also mutates from the monkeys. Now, over a long period of time, genes begin to make mistakes. And as they make mistakes, there is a mutation, or there is a genetic drift. These genes move as people move away, genes begin to form their own colony and produce something quite dissimilar to the monkey. But all we can tell you right now is about 25 million years, the monkey is in Africa. The monkey is in Africa and in Asia. But around the same time, the monkey is not in America and is not in Europe. The chimpanzee was only in Africa and in Asia. Now, the absence of the chimpanzee in America and Eurasia or parts of Europe will now, from that time onwards, cut off America and Europe from any forward process that would eventually lead to humans. So we would not be talking up to America or Europe about the process that leads to humans, because the lineage that leads to modern man comes out of the chimpanzee about 25 million years. Now, about 20 million years, or around the same time, was the formation of what they call the polar ice cap. Now, the polar ice cap, some give it 15 million years, some say it appeared much earlier. But what it means was the earth begins to get warm. And the earth begins to get warm, then the ice begins to collect in another place. If you have seen when it rains and there is a hailstorm, when it begins to get warm, you see ice or the hailstones collecting in one particular place. So the rest of the place is cleared, but the ice begins to collect in one place. So this is what happened also at the same time, because the ice begins to collect in one place, in the polar, around the North Pole and South Pole, the polar ice cap, and then the rest of the forest, you know, becomes warm, begins to get warm. But South America, North America still retain very cold weather, but Africa and parts of Asia begin to warm, particularly around the tropics. So what does that mean? As the world becomes warmer, the forest begins to retreat. The forest begins to retreat in Africa, creating parklands, you know, savanna, and even desert. The forest cover still remains in Europe, and the forest cover still remains in America. Now, in East Africa, you know, you need to understand this if you have to understand anything else. In East Africa, in Eastern Africa, or around the Lacustrine region, intracrustine region, the region between the lakes, of course, the lakes are not there at the time. The whole of East Africa is still a landmass covered by forest, although the forest is beginning to retreat. But 20 million years, there is another tectonic movement that takes place in East Africa, almost separating Africa. You know, this appears 20 million years, and it was the creation of what we call the Eastern Rift Valley. The Eastern Rift Valley starts all the way from the Transjordan and goes into what is present today, Mozambique. So what happens then? It means there's a movement on the tectonic plates underneath the earth, and the lava, you know, pours out and creates the Kenyan Dome and the Ethiopian Dome. And on the other side, it creates the dome, you know, that is now the Rwenzori. So the land that you now call Uganda, part of Ethiopia, Tanzania, all the way up to Malawi, is still what? Is almost a ditch. So that was supposed to be a sea. So when this happens, therefore, is that after a long, another period of time, the lava that had collected on top of these domes also comes tumbling into this ditch and creates some of the most amazing environment that you see today. It creates more shrubs, it creates more parklands, it gives us more savanna, forest enclaves, crater lakes, huge lakes, rivers, you know, a collection of stones, huge mountain, and a breathtaking environment that you see running all the way from the present day Jordan all the way up to Mozambique. Now, the creation of the Eastern Rift Valley would do something unique to the Lacustrine region that was not available in other parts of Africa or in other parts of Asia or in other parts of other continents. What does that mean? It creates a unique environment. Forest is pushed to one side, almost up to the Congo, almost up the Atlantic. Lush grassland, lots of water, lots of fertile soils because of the lava that has come from underneath. So, therefore, the chimpanzee that is in this forest has now to respond. Here appears what we call a call and response. What is a call and response? A call and response meaning an environmental change, a change in your environment, a change in your climate requires a phenotype change, a phenotypical change. It means that you have to change your behavior, and also you have to change yourself, because Now, most of these chimpanzees were living in the forest. So what did they have? They have a short snout. They have forward, longer limbs, forward ambulation, and they have stereoscopic vision. So they can see very well. But they have appendages around their arms, and they're also moving what we call quadrupeds. Quadrupeds meaning they're moving with four limbs, you know, quadrupeds. So now the chimpanzee is seated in the forest, and it begins to contemplate this new environment.
This grassland in the Rwenzori National Park is not dissimilar to the grassland that the chimpanzee would have faced 20 million years ago. 20 million years ago, after the creation of the Rift Valley, you find that the forest begins to retreat, like the forest you see in the background. As the forest retreats, the open savanna, parkland, and grassland becomes the new home for the chimpanzee. But the chimpanzee was used to living in the forest. And in the forest, it needed appendages on its arms to cling on, you know, to trees. So these chimpanzees would have to take very quick decisions. One is they are very heavy. You know, their calorie intake is heavy, so they need to reduce their weight. The second is that they have fur. They need to reduce their fur coat because under this open sky, the fur is not essential. In the forest, they were protected from the ultraviolet rays of the sun by the forest cover. But the forest cover has now retreated. So what does the chimpanzee need to do? It needs to drop its coat. Underneath the chimpanzee's fur is white skin. And this white skin is no good in the tropics because the skin will just get cancer. You know, white skin has no protection against the ultraviolet rays of the sun. And the chimpanzee needs the ultraviolet rays of the sun. So it needs to produce melanin immediately. Then the chimpanzee also needs to produce aquiline sweat glands. Aquiline sweat glands to carry the heat away from the body. And it also needs to learn how not to walk on four limbs, you know, or to be a quadruped, because now it has to search for food. It can no longer touch this tree and he get a fruit. He has to walk distances to get food and bring it to a colony. If you look at chimpanzees, they live together. Mother chimpanzee, grandfather chimpanzee, father chimpanzee. So one chimpanzee would go to look for food and it would need to use its hands to carry the food. The more it uses its hand, the more it found it needs to walk upright. The more it walked upright, the more it needed its hands to make tools, you know, to form a form of culture, you know, to begin using symbolic language. It also needs hands in the form of a language. But how does this happen? Mankind or humankind or animals cannot simply shed their skin, even if a demand in ecology calls for that. Changes of this time happen as a result of mutation over a long period of time, because over years, say 400 years, these genes begin to make mistakes. And as they make mistakes, they mutate. You know, they mutate and become something else. For example, about 8 million years, the gorilla separates itself from the chimpanzee. The gorilla separates itself from the chimpanzee 8 million years. And about 7 million years, from 5 to 7 million years, you find that the humans, the genus Homo Australopithecines, begin to break away from the chimpanzee and lead a forward march that would lead to humans.
So here we have now about 15 million years ago, where I said that the polar ice cap is really, cold weather in Europe begins to comes back. There is the chimpanzee living in African parts of Asia, but it is in Africa after the another drift, the movement, the tectonic movement that creates the Rift Valley and gets the highlands. And some of these animals come from the lowlands and go into the highland, and they begin to fend for themselves in a new way and a new scene and a new call and response that requires most of these chimpanzees to move from the forest and to start walking and to start moving. Now, about 8 million years, the gorilla separates itself from the chimpanzee. Because right now, another thing I need to tell you, because I might be talking about chimpanzee, and you begin to say to yourself, I'm not a chimpanzee. I really did not become from a chimpanzee. Well, actually, the chimpanzee's DNA is very close to that of the human being. You know, our genes are so close to those of the chimpanzee that we differ from the chimpanzee by 1 to 2%. That's the difference between us and chimpanzee in terms of genes, 1 to 2%. The rest of our genes, together with that chimpanzee, are so close. So we are 98% similar to the chimpanzee in genes. So about 8 million years, the gorilla separates itself from chimpanzees. There, by the way, at that time there were about 25 species of primates, but now there are only 4 left. There is the chimpanzee, the pygmy chimpanzee, which is only in Africa, and then there is the orangutan and the gibbon. You know, so these are the only primates, you know, that remain now. Now, I have to say to you that there was in somewhere in India, in the Himalayas, I think, a fossil that was discovered in Asia, which was called the preconsul. The preconsul was discovered and it was given a carbon date of 15 million years. It was carbon dated 15 million years. And it was discovered at a time when Europeans were asserting, really, that the only people that created a civilization, that were the first people to populate the world, came from Europe. And when they couldn't find a fossil in Europe, then they said it must be Asia. And so they started scouring the whole of Asia to find a fossil. And the oldest fossil that they got was what they called the preconsul. But the preconsul was not human. It was a monkey fossil. It was a primate. But it had canine, which they thought, you know, looked like that of a human being. And they used just the canine to assert that, yes, this is a modern human being. So what happens then is eventually, with the science of molecular biology asserted that humans are not older than 8 million years. And when molecular biology came in with the evidence saying, you know what, the age when humans drifted from chimpanzees is about between 7.5, you know, to 5 million years, or 10 to 5 million years. Nothing older than 8 million years. Biology is quite assertive. Molecular biologists are quite assertive, saying humans did not separate from chimpanzees until about 8 million years ago. So then again, they went and looked at this preconsul, and they said, well, this was really a monkey, but at that time there was a lot of monkey business going on vis-a-vis ancient fossils. This is the most controversial discipline that exists. Why? It's not controversy because they can't tell where humanity came from. It is not controversy because there is no evidence. It is not controversy because fossils, human fossils from Africa, go now into thousands. Before, the fossils could fit on a table or in a small laboratory, but now they go into their thousands. That's so many that we have even failed to count. But whoever populated the world first is therefore the father and mother of humanity itself. Whoever populated the world first is therefore the one whom we inherit all our genes from, whom we inherit our mitochondria genes from. Whoever populated the world first is the one that gives us our culture and everything that we stand for. So it was contestable. It was a very contestable thing. And that is why in 1776 in Germany, white people sat down, the people at Uttingen University in 1776, people like Blumach, Winckelmann, Humboldt, who was Prussia's foreign minister of education, people like Milner, sat down to say, no, let us scale down the mountain to Asia. Let us teach that humanity started from Asia, because we cannot give Africa the psychological advantage of knowing that humanity started in Africa. So they started teaching when they couldn't find an ancient fossil in Europe. That is when they started saying, okay, let us look towards Asia. And then they came with a preconsul, which was not human, and they started teaching that humanity started in Asia. So here we are now. We are at 10 million years. In summary, what am I saying? I am saying that the world comes into place about 3.4 billion years. Our world is about 3.4 billion years old. I am saying 80 million years is what we call the age of the prosimian. I am saying that 50 million years, the continental drift takes place. And what happens is the rest of the continent separates from Africa. And America is still together, but separates from Africa. America did not separate until 6 million years ago. So I am also saying that at 400 million years ago was the age of fish, 80 million to 50 million years is the age of the prosimian, the age before the monkeys, 40 million years is the age of monkeys. And I'm also saying at the time the whole world is covered by forest, it is wet, the forest is dense, and it is cold. I am also saying that 25 million years, there appears the primates, the chimpanzee. The chimpanzee is in Africa and parts of Asia. The absence of chimpanzee in America and North and North, what we call Eurasia, will mean it separates Eurasia and America from any process, any forward process that will lead to humans. I mentioned the age of monkeys and how they were. I also told you that these monkeys had stereoscopic vision. They had a smaller scalp or smaller brain. They had forward ambulation, and they had appendages attached to their hands. Now the chimpanzee comes into crisis after the formation of the Rift Valley and after the formation of the polar ice cap, and it finds that had to adopt or die. Some of the chimpanzees or the different species, 25 species, did not survive. Of course, the one that survives would lead onto a forward march, march that would get it into humans. Now, about 40 million years, most of these forests, the forest cover, is populated by a lot of species of monkeys. In the Paleontology, we fast forward to about 24 million years, and that is what we call the age of the chimpanzee, or the great chimpanzee. Now, this chimpanzee is so close to humans that we actually differ from the chimpanzee's DNA by 1 to 2%. About 20 million years, and it is good that, you know, they say they are brothers from Burundi, they said Burundi and Tanzania. 20 million years, an event takes place in East Africa that is of complete importance. And you must study this. 20 million years ago is another tectonic movement, but this time it affects only Eastern Africa. And by Eastern Africa, we mean the whole area from the Transjordan all the way up to the Mozambique. There is another movement where Earth gets open, lava pours out. In the West, it creates the Rwenzori Dome, the Muhafura Dome, the so-called East Western Rift Valley. So lava would pile up to make this huge mold that becomes these ranges. In the east, it creates the Kenya Dome, the Ethiopian Dome, all the way up to Malawi. After time, this collected lava comes tumbling in this huge ditch, because from Jordan up to Malawi, that would have been a huge ditch. Now, when this ditch is covered eventually by a few post-tectonics, it creates crater lakes, parklands, bushland, you know, savanna, mountain ranges, you know, the breathtaking environment that you see in East Africa. That is why you drive to Kasese and you see a crater lake, you see a mountain, you see a hill, you see valleys. That was because this ditch was being filled, and it was not being filled evenly. Now, when this tectonic movement appeared, most of the forest was incinerated. Most of the forest and the plant life was incinerated. That's the reason for oil in this great region. The reason for oil. Because of that incineration that took place 20 million years ago. So the forest cover is pushed into the Congo. The whole of this becomes now an open grassland and the savanna and the parkland with water and rivers. You know, the beautiful environment that we have. We assume that the chimpanzees that lived around that time, they found themselves exposed outside the forest. So the chimpanzee now, which had a lot of fur, needed to shed the fur to protect itself against the ultraviolet rays of the sun. And the only thing that protects you against the ultraviolet rays of the sun is this skin, black skin pigmentation, that is called melanin. This melanin is produced by an enzyme. The enzyme is called melatonin. For melatonin to produce melanin, it needs a catalyst enzyme we call tyrosinase 7. If you have no tyrosinase 7, you can survive by black skin. Now, this black skin pigmentation is responsible for a lot of things. Melanin protects you against the ultraviolet rays of the sun and the energy from the earth. It anchors you, it is like earthing. Melanin controls fatigue.
So you can sit in a plane to Australia, jump off and go and do some, you know, strategic planning. Melanin controls aging cycle. So at 56, you'll still look good because of melanin. Melanin controls healing. In fact, if you cut yourself and there's a wound, before, when it is getting better, you start seeing the darker skin coming. That is melanin. Melanin also gives you what they call dominant genes. In biology, you need to register a gentleman called Gregory Mendel. And please go and read after him. Don't think this is what Kiwankwa said. Gregor Mendel. Gregory Mendel. Mendel is M-A-A-D-A-L. He is the father of genetics. Mendel carried out a lot of experiments in the 18th century, 1822. And basically what he was trying to do at the time, white people were looking for something that can show them that it was humanity started in Europe, nowhere else. So they wanted now molecular biology to back them. And Gregor Mendel steps in the fray. He says, we can find out. And he found that white people have what they call recessive genes, and black people have what they call dominant genes. After several experiments, Mendel concluded that if he had begun with white people, you would never have produced black people, because a recessive can never produce a dominant. A recessive gene can never produce a dominant gene. You, as a black person, can produce a white person, but no two white chickens can produce a brown chicken. No two white goats can produce a black goat. I'm sure some of you have goats, surely. You know, you can go and repeat this experiment. No two white cows can produce any kind of a cow, but two black cows can produce anything else. You know, that is just basic elements of molecular biology. So the chimpanzee, after 20 million years ago, needed to produce tyrosine 7 to be able to protect itself against the ultraviolet rays of the sun. You know, it needed to produce aquiline sweat glands. You know, because, you know, when you are living in the sun, you start sweating. You know, and that sweat is also necessary. If you are not sweating, then you are in trouble. So, by about 5.5 million years, we saw, about 7 million years, a mutation took place only in East Africa. And that mutation was the gorilla separates from the chimpanzee. That is why they are only, the gorillas are only in East Africa, in Congo, in Rwanda, and Uganda. Nowhere else. Because that is where nature was playing all these revolutionary changes were taking place in East Africa in natural times. Then about 5.5 million years, you get the first human being who is called the Australopithecine. Australopithecine is a Greek word. It simply means thousand-based ape man. Australopithecine, 5.5 million years. From the Australopithecine, the next stage of humanity is what they call Homo habilis. Homo habilis, certainly, it means handyman. A black ancestor who used tools. At that time, there is nobody in Europe, there is nobody in Asia, there is no one in South America. Humanity is only where you are. Only. There is no other scholar who will stand in front of you and say, oh, this is debatable. No, it is a case-closed argument. Humanity was in East Africa from 5.5 million years ago. Australopithecine, 5.5 million years. The oldest Australopithecine was discovered in Ethiopia by a guy called Sesigai and Donald Johansson. It was carbon dated 5.5 million years ago. And why? Because fossils, when you die and something is fossilizing, it produces carbon-14, which is radioactive. And it has a stable shelf life. You know, so you are able to tell how old, you know, to some negative and positive, a few years difference, how old this is. So, about 1.5 million years, in a place called Naria Katomi, near northern Turkana, in northern Kenya, a fossil of the Homo erectus. Homo erectus is your ancestor that walked upright. Naria Katomi, near Lake Turkana, it was discovered by Kamoya Kimeyo and Liki, and it was carbon dated by Oxford 1.5 million years. Still, 1.5, nobody else on earth, apart from East Africa, keep the fire burning. You know, you make a fire, you sit, you tell stories. That is inside you, you know, from a long time ago. Just like I said, 3.5 million years ago, the tool maker, the African tool maker, the Homo
use as a computer to, you know, set it all straight. And when you are driving to Kampala, you reach Namahojono, your car breaks down. Now you go and get a guy who never goes to school, can't write his name. He comes with a cigarette. He says, "Start." He listens. He says, "Okay, just hold on." He goes, he sorts your car out, he moves.
Now, don't you ever ask yourself, how does he do it? He didn't go to school, he didn't study, he has not sat in a air-conditioned lecture room, but he's able to do what something, somebody, somewhere who studied so much, put together and thought, I've got this close. Because it is in us. That technology is in us. You know, we are the tool makers. We have more tools before we can make them again. 1.5 million years is Homo erectus. Now, about 600,000 years, this African Homo erectus leaves Africa through Kenya, populates some of the islands, and makes his way into India and all those islands. He also follows the Nile, crosses into what is the Suez Canal, because the whole of that area, what we call Jordan, Palestine, was known in ancient times as Northeast Africa, as was Saudi Arabia. Actually, the word Saudi Arabia means Black Arabia. So he populates that land at the stage of Homo erectus. Now, about 80,000 years ago, humanity witnesses what they call Homo sapien, modern man. Man who could sit in here, or a woman who could sit in here and look like me and you. Modern man. Now, it was discovered by Leakey, it was carbonated by Cambridge, 130,000 years.
You say the black, for us with the black skins, we are the one with this melanin. But why now, our life expectancy is very short than the white men who doesn't have this melanin. Why it comes like that?
Because less than 15% of the world population use 89% of the world resources. And those resources are not in Europe. 15% of the world population is white people. They use resources from Africa and Asia. They don't have resources. What is the natural resource of England? A bit of coal, which is not exploitable, some little oil in the North Sea, and some Irish potatoes. To be specific, they are not even Irish. They came from Mexico. And they were brought into England, into Ireland, and the Ireland were eating oats, and they got excited when they see the big potatoes. They abandoned growing oats, they planted the first crop, and they had a potato famine. And that's how they floated to the Americas. But that population, 15%, want all the resources of the world. And who is standing in front of them? You. They have worked out that out of the 6 billion people that populate the world, they want to reduce the population to 800 million. In order to reduce population quickly, you have to draw all men into fighting and kill significant numbers of childbearing age females. That is number one, civil war. Number two is famine. Nature's natural checks, famine and disease. Once they have put it in your mind that you are not going to live beyond 50 or 40, you won't even fight. You say, I'm about to die anyway, why do I have to fight? My life expectancy. Life expectancy, my mother is 180 years old. He can still go and see her cows. Most people in my village, 80, 90, they don't even wear glasses. When people come to visit me from outside Africa, the first thing they notice is how few glasses are. When I was growing up, we thought that to have glasses was to be rich. So that expectancy, life expectancy, I said melanin is produced by an enzyme called melatonin. And for melatonin produced melanin, it needs a catalyst enzyme called tyrosinase 7. Yes. It controls hearing. You as a black person can live in the most remote. In military terms, if your enemy says true, you know it is false. Or it is not even there. If he says short, you know it is tall. You know? And white people play that game wonderfully. Wonderfully. That is the whole thing about life expectancy. Me, I expect to live up to 90. And I make it. I will live up to 90.
I know my father lived up to 100. So he didn't even know that somebody had expected him to die at 30. Go and promote your own drinks from Ajon or Shera or something from your community. You know, if a general holds something, you know, other people will want to drink it. Teach them new standards. Start like General Tumwine. He went and started packing Besa. That is a strategic thing. The Japanese were able to use food to raise their people up. Don't eat white bread. Stay away from margarine, trying to show people that you are well-to-do. You know, one of the ingredients is body lice. Stay away from all the quenchers. Have organic food. Don't eat breakfast. Breakfast means breaking the fast of the previous night. You are supposed to allow space in the morning between when you wake up and when you eat your first meal. When you go to sleep, your digestive system goes to sleep. When you wake up, the reason you are running to the toilet is because your digestive system wakes up. So allow some time between when you wake up and when you eat your first meal. Don't go katogo, you know, sandwich, you know, no. Leave that. Let the body deal with the food you ate before. Every week, have a raw diet. Say, I'm going to eat raw food.